Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam upon all the messengers of Allah. We carry on from where we left in the previous talk, and that is, before doing something, Allah takes into account many factors. Those many factors, between inverted commas, okay, are what we call parameters. In mathematics, where we have an equation, some parameters are variables, they change, and some others are constant. But anyhow, we use a combination and to get to the result. So, for example, we take the example of you asking Allah for $1 million. So, Allah, you make the dua, and then can Allah answer the dua? Of course He can. Can He give you $1 million? Of course He can give you $1 million. Do you need to work for to get that million? No, you don't need to. Allah can give it to you without any issues at all. But will Allah do it? Now that is the question. Will Allah do it? The answer is no. He will not do it. And here is why. Because when you ask Allah to give you $1 million, Allah will go to work. He will calculate. He will need to have that $1 million that you asked. He's not going to create it out of thin air. Because if He creates it out of thin air, He is going to have to give it a bank. Allah is not going to create $1 million and then have a bank do just add values to your tickets and give them reference number and have the equivalent of gold just for your beautiful eyes. Allah is not going to do that. Okay, and Allah is not certainly going to take the money from the bank. If He has forbidden us from stealing, He certainly is not going to steal or deceive anybody to do anything. So that $1 million that you asked Allah about is not going to be created out of thin air. It has to be notes. These notes have to be printed by a bank. And those notes will have to have a reference number. And they will have to be backed up by a value of gold. Okay? So, when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all these parameters will be taken into consideration. So, if Allah is going to take $1 million to give it to you, then He must balance it out with other factors. So, your dua, even if a prophet makes this dua or anyone on earth makes that dua, Allah is not gonna answer it because it just doesn't follow the book of law, the rules that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written upon Himself. This is why in the Quran many times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ, and He is the most capable of everything. And this is in Surah Hud, surah number 11, and the ayah is number 4. Why does He tell us that? Well, He tells us that because at times we ask Allah things, and if He doesn't give us to us, we might think that He couldn't give us to them. No. Allah says, I am capable of doing everything. He even created a human without a father. Okay? And He created, He even created Jesus alayhi salam. But because humans cannot fathom Allah's powers, it was too easy for them to attribute Jesus as son of God, or son to Allah. So next time before you make dua, make sure your dua does not break any other laws that are in harmony working out there. As I said earlier on, Allah is in constant calculation of probabilities. The same thing in life. You see, in life there are so many variables. You are a constant. You don't change. You are you as a human being, right? So that's that. A man is a man. He will never ever change into a woman. Even if somebody changes their sexes and they do everything, guess what? Their genomes, the genes in them, they cannot conceive. Those traits that are specific for a male, they will never be able to be passed on to another woman. If they take estrogen and whatever, they do everything in their form to look like a woman, but they will always be a man. And same thing. But anyhow, that is not about that. What I'm talking about here is that you are a constant. The variables are the things out there or the humans out there that can change. Let me give you an example. Yeah. When it comes to building a family. Okay. You are the constant. You don't change. But your partner might and can change. Okay, endless examples can be given, but again, as I said, I'm going to just take the human relationship and progeny. In the world of maths, a variable is a range of possibility or possible values that any one element can have. I'm sure you've heard this in your life. X plus Y or A plus B equals C. Now you're going to say, oh, please, no math. No, I'm not going to get into math. I'm just telling you this. A is a variable. It changes. The value of A changes. The value of B changes. And because these two, what that means is, if I say somewhere in the equation that A equals 1 and B equals 2, then A plus B equals C, and C becomes 3. So it's like me saying 1 plus 2 equals 3, or A plus B equals C. So because now you know that those variables of the A and B have now got some values that define them. So this is math at its very, very, very basic formation. So if we take this simple equation of 1 plus 1 equals 2. In this equation, 1 is a variable and 2 is also a variable. But because a plus, okay, the equation, the element of addition is a constant. It doesn't change. A plus is always a plus. It never changes. Minus is always a minus. It never changes. Okay? But I can change 1 and I can change 2. Let me give you, this is going to blow your mind a little bit, but hey, it's part of the deal. 1 plus 1 equals, if you answer 2, I need to tell you, in what realm, in what field are we on talking? You're going to say math. I'm going to say, okay. Because in humans, 1 plus 1 can equal 6. One man plus one woman, they get married. How many humans they produce? They can produce 6. At which case, 1 plus 1 equaled 6 kids. And now because we have a different set of equation, we need to give that equation a field of application. We cannot apply it everything. However, if we have two cars moving in the same direction at, say, 100 miles each, so 1 plus 1, so 1 car plus 1 car, we're going to have 0 because they're going to collide and they're going to explode and we're going to lose 2 cars. Again, the same equation of 1 plus 1, because we have changed the field of application, the outcome will change. So now, let me go back to the family building. You are one woman. We are almost 8 billion people on Earth. We're going to split into two parts, right? So let's say 4 billion men, 4 billion women. Ignore kids and all that kind of stuff. I'm just going to... Now, you, my brother, or my sister, if you married each of every billion out there, like you're going to get tons of kids, guess what? How does Allah calculate or give you the kid with the looks that you married? Your children, you look at them now. Let me give you an example of myself, all right, my own mother. My own mother is a red-haired woman with green eyes, with beautiful pimple on her face, as white as they come, okay? My dad is a hazel-eyed guy with light brown hair, white also as well. I don't look any like them. I don't have the hair, even though my hair has got some feature of my mother's hair. But my eyes are not green, and certainly I don't look like my mother. So much so that when they see me with my mother, when she says, this is my son, we always get that deadly question, and the look on the face, and that is when they are polite. Or, oh, because I don't look like my mother at all. Okay. And when I am with my dad, same thing, I don't look like my dad. So where do my looks come from, I wonder? Well, when I used to be, when we used to study university and all, we used to be taught in biology something called the Punnett square, P-U-N-N-E-T square. And go on YouTube, they will explain to you. And this is like you take a square, then you split it in the middle, so you have two halves, and then horizontally, you split the two halves, and you've got four halves. And then, for example, yeah, I'm not going to get into details, but just make it simple, right? The mother has got green eyes, Okay, white, green eyes. So we're going to put some of her characteristics in quadrant one, the top left. And then we're going to take the usually they put the man on top and the woman on the bottom. So we're going to put the father on the top and the woman, for example, she is a Chinese. Her eyes are black. And then with these quadrants and some calculation, we can work what the kid that is going to born, will get born to these two, will look like. We used to do this at the university before, at high college, things like that. And I used to love this because we used to do this and I used to, sometimes you get it wrong, sometimes you get it right, sometimes the calculations get tough because of the breed of the humans and the colors, but it used to be fun. We humans could do that. Well, guess what? The same diagram that we use, well, Allah doesn't use the same one, but he uses his, and his is complex. Because just for me, if I could see my ancestors, I might be looking like my 20th grandfather who used to live elsewhere, that lived in, under certain conditions, and I look like him. Of course, I carry a little bit of the genomes or the genes of other people, but I still look, and because my dad carried those genes of my grandfather, so on and so forth. So my looks have been decided based on calculations. They were not just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sitting like this or do this. No, no, no. It's Allah calculates. Allah calculates. This is why if there was no end of time, eternity didn't have an end, Allah could carry on creating every time non-stop. And he would never run out of options because the same rule of calculations, all he has to do is just apply it once after the other. See, 1 plus 1, you can apply it eternally. It will always give you the same results, and the same thing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear sisters and my brothers, the marriage equation is the same for all humans. And with that equation, Allah manages the results. You see, Allah uses the same results, same equation to calculate your kids, my kids, his kids. So in a day's time, Allah could use the same equation 8 billion times, because it's the same one, and he uses it for all. The process of creation, a human being, my sisters and my brothers, and designing a human being is a very complex. Taking two waters, a sperm, white sperm, and an egg, a red blood egg, and then you mix them together, two waters, and out of that two waters comes a complete human, oh God, brain, bones, thinking, emotions, a human being. This complex is absolutely, this way is absolutely complex. We humans can never ever build a human being. It's incredibly impossible because the amount of calculations that go to making a human being are beyond belief. Look at the hospital. When we fall sick, when we go to the everything, our medication is calculated. How much of this is calculated? We take of our blood, it's calculated. They will tell you you've got 1,000 milligrams of this and that. Everything in us evolves around calculation and math. This is why Allah takes it personally when a human being as advanced as they are doesn't believe in Allah. Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha al-insan, you human, ma gharraka bi rabbika al-kareem, what has seduced you away from your gracious caretaking God? الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ فَسَوَّاكَ, he who has designed you, created you, and then proportioned you. فِي أَيِّ صُورَةٍ مَا شَاءَ رَكَّبَكَ, in whatever image. And I remember when I told you, but maybe I could be taken from my 20th grandfather? Because Allah has decided, according to his calculations, that I should look like my 20th grandfather. So that decision, could Allah have changed it? Of course he could have. He could have played with the pyramids and make me look something else. But Allah didn't want that to do that. And he created me according to that grandfather's genes and everything. So that's why he says, in whatever image in your ancestors he willed, he mounted you. Isn't this a God? You take his water and you create a human being. So what Allah is saying is saying to us is that based on the data he receives from our parents. You see, Allah needs our data, our parents, our data, to make something. Because Allah is not going to create out of thin air. Can he do it? Of course he can. He created Jesus. He created Adam. He created even things like that. But will he do it? No. So Allah receives data from our parents. And who themselves receive that from their from my grandparents, then grand-grandparents, and then it goes all the way to my ancestors. Then Allah, armed with all this data, decides which of those genomes, these genes, he will then let win the looks battle. As humans, we only provide Allah with the initial material, sperm and an egg. With that, he then carries on with the rest of the task. And to make a human being, my brothers and my sisters, out of sperm and blood, it is a huge favor that Allah does upon us. So how come you human, you missed all this huge favor? Allah undertook the rest of the process and took the outcome from your parents and made you into a full-blown human. But is the creation of a human being the biggest of Allah's creation? With the complexities that are dwelling in us, are we actually the biggest of what Allah has created? Well, you'll be surprised that we are not the most complex of Allah's creation, but it is rather the creation of the heavens and the earth. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Ghafir, Ghafir is the Surah number 40, in Ayah 57, he says, لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ. The creation of the heavens and the earth is greater than the creation of human beings. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. But most people do not know. But why would Allah tell us this? Well, because we humans will one day at one point fail to look. If we could not get the belief from a small tiny humans, then certainly the creation of the heaven and earth must lead us to believe in Allah. And this leads me to the next point, my dear sisters and my brothers, talking about the human's creation. In a very surprising statement made by Allah, in which he declares that either he creates a human being, one, or he creates 100 trillion humans at the same time, to him it all is very easy, and to him it all is as if he created one single person. Say, 100,000 babies are conceived exactly at the same minute. Okay? Millions of couples around the world at any one given time are having sex. And out of those millions of couples, babies, okay, millions of them, they conceive few babies. And then the process of creation starts right there and then, as soon as the sperm meets the egg, the process creation. So how does Allah do all that? It's zillions of them. Well, as far as Allah is concerned, the creation of humans is as simple as creating either one or 1 trillion of them in 1 second. To him, it all is extremely easy and takes place at the same time. And the answer is really simple once you start seeing things from the same angle as Allah. Our good Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, messaged us saying, he sent us a message, the Quran. مَا خَلْقُكُمْ وَلَا بَعْثُكُمْ إِلَّا كَنَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. Your creation or your resurrection, all of you, is only like creating or resurrecting a single soul. إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ. Allah is all hearing and all seeing. And this is in Surah Luqman, that is Surah 31, in the Ayah 28. In another Ayah, Allah declares to us in a very sinister truth. It's powerful, really powerful. He says, if anyone kills one single human, it is as if he has or she has killed the entire humanity. And also if they have revived one human, it is as if they have revived the entire humanity. How is that possible? How is that if someone shoots somebody, kills one person in the sight of Allah, that person equals the killings of an entire humanity? Allah says, أَنَّهُ مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And whoever kills a soul, unless for a soul, i.e. someone kills, gets killed. Or for corruption, for example, like drug cartels, they sell drugs and then they have to be executed, okay, because they have done corruption on the land. Allah, these two, if they get killed for that, they are exempted. No retaliation is against the killer. That is, if the government executes a killer or executes a drug lord, nobody's going to tell the government, you killed, you must be killed, because Allah has given them authority to take a soul based on the evil. But other than that, it is as if they have killed all people. فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا. And whoever revives it or gives life to it, it is as if he had saved mankind entirely. And this is in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Surah number 5, and the ayah is 32. Well, the reason this ayah takes as such a meaning, you kill one, it is as if you have killed the entire humanity. You revive one, it is as if you have revived the entire humanity. The only reason this can be as such is because life and death, both of them are run by one equation. Each one has got its own algorithm. Meaning, if you kill someone, you have activated that algorithm. So one algorithm kills one. See, death, we die differently. Someone is killed by a car, someone is shot, someone eaten by a shark, someone overdose of drugs, someone alcoholic. You name it and it's there. Death is different. But the act of dying, the act of the angel of death, taking the soul out of a person is done one way. We all die the same way. The end is the same. The moment when we die, is the means are different. But death itself is one. And the same thing, reviving takes place from one. But we can revive someone differently, right? But here, so the only way this is possible is because as soon as someone kills someone, they have triggered the algorithm of death. And this is why in the sight of Allah, if you trigger the algorithm of death for one, to Allah, it is as if you have triggered it for the entire humanity, because death is subjective to one and only algorithm. Allah says in the Quran about this topic, أَفَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا تُمْنُونَ. Have you seen what you ejaculate? أَأَنْتُمْ تَخْلُقُونَهُ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْخَارِقُونَ. Is it you who created and formed into a human being? Or are we the creator? نحن قدرنا بينكم الموت. It is us that have calculated death amongst you all. وما نحن بمسبوقين. And none can beat us. If we ever wanted to make someone die or live, no one can do that. What Allah is saying this is, death, Allah has set laws for that algorithm when to take place. To give you an example to bring it to reality, I would say this. When you are driving your car, you certainly have seen green and red lights on the road. Green lights comes in, you pass and you drive. Red lights comes in, you stop. How is that? Both of them are run by algorithms. That algorithm can be triggered in so many different ways. Two of which is time or senses. If, for example, they put the program that every 60 seconds, the algorithm of green gets triggered. Well, then the computer calculates 60 seconds, and on the 60th second, the algorithm of red or green gets triggered, and the light turns green, you stop or you drive. Okay, senses at night when the traffic is not busy, they have senses. Those senses, they calculate the distance. Say a car is 10 meters away. So when the car is coming, the senses calculate the length where the car is, and the algorithm gets triggered accordingly. Well, then guess what? Giving life, changing all that life and death, both of them are said, are subjected to an algorithm. So the end, can someone live for 600 years? Not in our times. Because Allah now has set the algorithm to trigger death after a number of years. Okay, I haven't seen anyone that lived to 170 years. Why? I'm just giving an example here, right? Allah has set the algorithm of death to trigger 130. 130 is maximum time of a person can live. Why? Because of gravity, nutrition, and all these elements, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, since the law that governs death was written by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that each human being shall die. Well, yeah, that's why Allah says in the Quran, كل نفس ذائقة الموت. Anything that breathes shall taste death. Look at how Allah puts it. He didn't say كل نفس ميتة. Each soul is going to die. Each soul is going to taste of death, of the equation of death, of the algorithm of death. It is going to happen to you. Just like you say, every soul shall taste bitter. So the bitter is one, it doesn't change. But humans, in so many souls, will taste that bitterness. So my sisters and my brothers, the algorithm of when we are going to die, Allah has not decided. But it is there, and death, the equation, the end of our lives, gets triggered by many factors. For example, if someone got diabetes, that is one trigger that triggers the algorithm of death. Driving extremely fast cars, that might trigger the death algorithm. An overdose of cocaine or heroin will trigger that. Sinking, being thrown in the middle of the oceans will trigger the death, the algorithm of death. And once the algorithm of death is triggered, it's only a moment until it takes place. And this is why Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تَمُوتَ. And it is not given to any breathing soul to die, إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ, except with the permission of Allah, again the trigger of the algorithm. Why, ya Allah? He says, كِتَابًا مُؤَجَّلًا, death being a collection of delayed parameters. When all the parameters are existing, or they exist, then they trigger the algorithm of death. And again, since death follows a calculation, an equation to calculate, and since the messenger of Allah, subhanAllah, it's incredible how Allah talks to us in the Quran. You see, anyone who breathes, be that a human being, be that a fish, be that a lion, anything, be that bacteria, anything that interacts with oxygen and things like that, then his death is a subject to the equation of death, which triggers an algorithm. And this is why Allah tells the messenger, his messenger Muhammad, so that no one can claim that the messenger is alive, even though it is preached in the Quran. We still find some denominational Muslims. They tell you, oh, the messenger comes every Jum'ah after Salat, and he does this. I think it's Brilwis who do this. Allah doesn't say, no way, Jose. Or that the messenger is in the grave and he's enjoying his life and things like that. It doesn't happen like that. Look at what Allah says in the Quran. إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. You are to die, i.e. the algorithm of death that will apply on you, ya Muhammad, and they are to die. That same algorithm of death that's going to trigger death shall apply on them. ثُمَّ إِنَّكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ عِنْدَ رَبِّكُمْ تَخْتَصِمُونَ. Then on the day of resurrection, you, with all everyone else, will settle your dispute before your God. My dear sisters and my brother, death, or the equation of death for each individual, is based on the parameters that will trigger the algorithm of death. Each soul that dies on earth dies by that algorithm. Now, you trigger that algorithm when you kill one human, in the sight of Allah, since that algorithm can kill the entire humanity, for Allah, it is as if you have created the entire humanity, and because giving life, you also use it through an algorithm. So when you trigger that saving life, give a life algorithm, in the sight of Allah, it is as if you have given or saved the life of all humanity, because all that happens of one algorithm. I will now go to subsistence of the risk equation, and then we'll stop, inshallah, because the talk is taking far longer than I anticipated. Well, there is a life fact, my dear sisters and my brothers, about how Allah manages life on earth. You see, Allah's proportion, Allah is a smart God. He's very intelligent, Allah. He's not some cookie God like the Christians. It's just because he gave us his son to die for us, and so God's kind of like begging for us to love him. No. Allah is extremely intelligent. He gave us intelligence. He's extremely intelligent. He is a smart. He does things like Allah. So, but every year, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala runs the budget of earth. You see, a company, every year they work out the annual general meeting, right? And they decide how much budget for this year, what they're going to do and all that. Well, Allah does exactly the same thing for earth. Do you know when he does that? I will tell you in a bit. You see, Allah says this in Al-Quran. But before I get that, every year humanity increases in number of humans. So Allah adjusts the earth resources so that all people on earth and everybody that is on earth and that is affected by the earth, well, all their needs are catered for. As we grow in numbers, we also grow on how we make a living. For example, the amount of fish, how many fish are going to be in the ocean, the machineries we use to cater for agriculture needs, how much water do we need, how much clothing do we need, how much cotton, and things like that. You see, back in time, if you go like hundreds of thousands of years before, the amount of cotton we used to produce is extremely less than what we produce today. The amount of wheat we used to produce back in time is absolutely very insignificant in how much we produce today, right? Well, because humanity, the more we add, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adjusts what's on earth so that it fulfills our needs. So humanity's growth on earth is dictating of the resources of the earth. And what does Allah do? Well, he manages all that for us. He's the big manager. That's why he is Rabbul Alamin, the one, the caretaker of the universe. Because he is up there, wherever he is in the heavens up there, and he's looking on earth, and just like a CEO or general manager or director of a company, he sees where there are weaknesses, where there is a need, and then he calculates and donates, and people there and things like that, right? Well, that's exactly what he does. Look at what Allah says in the Quran. Well, when he talks about taking care of all survivors and the calculations he makes and everything, Allah says, أَهُمْ يَقْسِمُونَ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّكَ. Do they divide the grace and mercy of your God? And this is about people who do the job, who wants to do the job of Allah. Salafis, to them, you gotta do this to enter Jannah. Not what Allah says in the Quran. They dictate what they see it, the truth, so that people enter Jannah, even if it contradicts the Quran, but they still insist, okay? So I'll tell them, do you divide the grace and mercy of Allah? And then Allah says, نَحْنُ قَسَمْنَا بَيْنَهُمْ مَعِيشَتَهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. It is us, i.e. Allah alone, who has divided their livelihood among them in this life. On earth today, I'm just going for math, yeah? There are, for example, yeah, 100 million money everywhere, like all the currencies on earth today, they all equal $100 million. That's it. Now, when Allah divides how much you should get out of the money, he does it in proportion to the other people. So he gives you 10,000, he has to take that 10,000 from elsewhere. If the other one makes 100,000, he has to reduce it from elsewhere. Now you're gonna, do you know why there are rich people and poor people? because the poor people were lazy and the rich people were not. So the rich got the money that the poor people should have taken. That's why Allah tells us, donate money, give sadaqah, and let the rich people bestow on the poor people, not only to feed them, but also to give them an opportunity to make as much money as the other ones do. Why? Because people will only act in those 100 million. They cannot do. No, the earth grows, then the 100 million grow. Okay, now, وَرَفَعْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَاتٍ, and we raised some of the humans upon the others to certain degrees. Why, Ya Allah, did you do that? لِيَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا سُخْرِيًا, so that they use each other's skill. You see, not everybody is bright at school. Do you know why? Because we need a bus driver, we need a machinist, we need a street cleaner, we need a banker, we need a chef, we need all kinds of different people to have a life. And Allah divides these kind of abilities so that He makes sure that the earth keeps going on. That's why we have skills, and Allah does divide those things so that we use all those skills. And then Allah says, وَرَحْمَةُ رَبِّكَ خَيْرٌ مَّا يَجْمَعُونَ, and the mercy of your God, of this caretaking God, is much better than what they accumulate. So don't make all the time money your goal. When you have what you need to live with and things like that, alhamdulillah, concentrate on getting the mercy of your God. Therefore, my dear sisters and my brothers, a humans or animal risk or any other creatures on earth, their sustenance follows a mathematical equation with many parameters, and Allah regulates the outcome of these equations. Then algorithms get written and algorithms are put to place and they start acting. Anyone who triggers the algorithm of richness will get rich. Anyone who triggers the algorithm of poverty will become poor. Anyone who triggers the algorithm of theft will steal. Anyone who triggers the algorithm of fornication will fornicate. Anyone who triggers the algorithm of backbiting will backbite. It's all about triggering those rules that Allah has made, and they are represented by algorithm. This is why Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ إِنَّ رَبِّي يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ, say, it is my Rabb, my caretaker God, who extends the subsistence, the risk, okay, as He wishes. And it is Him who counts it and restricts it. وَهُوَ وَيَقْدِرْ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, but most people do not know. My dear sisters and my brothers, subsistence, or the subsistence equation, or the algorithm, are running through with many parameters. Allah runs them with so many parameters, and as soon as someone fulfills them, then Allah intervenes to adjust the outcome. If you drink wine, the algorithm of getting drunk is triggered. You get drunk. If you jump out from a building to kill yourself, you have triggered the death algorithm. And then you will die, and so on and so forth. So, based on this, now we are far more in a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know how Allah operates. We know how Allah performs. We know how Allah gets things done. What's my job and your job? Well, my job is that we use the algorithm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put on earth. And once we trigger each algorithm, guess what? We get the results we want. This is why on Judgment Day, when someone fornicates, they can't come to Allah and say, you've written this on me that I fornicate. Allah says, no. I did not write that you fornicate. I wrote the algorithm of fornication, and you, out of your choice, you triggered that algorithm, and zina took place and fornication took place. So my job was just to make that the algorithm works. Who triggered it? It's you. This is why on Judgment Day, we are held responsible over our choices, which algorithm to trigger, the good algorithms or the bad algorithm. In the next talk, inshallah, in the part, the upcoming part, I will talk about how Allah uses math to run the sun, the moon, to run the day after the judgment day, and many other elements, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on judgment day will count us one by one. That's why he says in the Quran, وَعَدَّهُمْ عَدَّ. There are so many ayat in the Quran when Allah tells us how exactly He is going to run judgment day, how He is going to reward us. One good deed will equal 10. There you go. That's the quantum again. And one vile deed will equal just one. If someone does this, we'll get that. So all those things, bi'idhillah, in my upcoming talk. Until then, enjoy this discovery and learn to love Allah as He wants to be loved through the Quran. Read the Quran if you can read Arabic, but don't read it through the eyes of the Shaykh or the Salafis or my eyes or any other eyes. Read them through your own eyes. Al-Quran is a message that you received through WhatsApp phone. That WhatsApp is the human Prophet Muhammad. Okay, or any other prophet, they deliver the message of your God to you, to your caretaker, to your Lord. Now the onus is on you. What you're going to do with this is entirely up to you. But then on Judgment Day, Allah will ask you about what you have done. So my dear sisters and my brothers, ensure that you start loving Allah, appreciating what He does to us. What you're going to cover in the upcoming talks is going to further deepen our love to Allah and further blow our mind, because there is a lot that Allah has said in the Quran, but our sheikhs and our scholars have become just like those priests and rabbis who only tell people what suits them, not what Allah wants from them. And my job at the end of the day is just to help you understand that there are other things in Al-Quran. I'm just kind of like removing the top layers. And I encourage you, if you can read Arabic, read. If you cannot, make it a point to read the English. But again, you must not just read the Quran or the meanings of the Quran in English, because the translations are being or made according to agendas. Okay? So every day, take what? 5-6 ayat? Sit down. And look at the general meaning. Hardly ever any of you sends me a message, what does this ayah mean? How do I understand it? Until now, I haven't had any of you working on a small anything and send it to me to double check it. Are you doing correct? Is there? No. Everybody's just still content with what they already got from the past. And that is one of big problem, because the Quran talks to us. On Judgment Day, Allah is going to tell us, I said that in Al-Quran. Our excuse is not going to be, oh, I didn't know. That's not going to eat at all. It's not going to pass. Okay? So, but anyhow, I pray to Allah that you find in what I have said enough enlightenment. Wa sallallahu ala kulli al-anbiya'i wa rusul. This is again your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my WhatsApp group, please do send me a message on 07876408735. Until my next talk, I leave you all with in the mercy of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.